was asking the Lord what he would have me to share with this beautiful family congregation, congregation of friends in this Thanksgiving prayer. And the Lord gave me three words, which all start with the letter H. Okay, three words. The first word is hallelujah. Hallelujah. The scripture says, he who finds a wife finds a good thing and obtains a favor from the Lord. And we read that in Proverbs 18 and verse 22. Japheth, it is the Lord who gave you Preethi. Preethi, it is the Lord who gave you Japheth. So it's time to say hallelujah. So that's the first day. Hallelujah. And as families, we can join together and sing hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's the Lord who gives us our spouses. It is the Lord who gives us our family. And a Bible commentator by the name of Clark said, whosoever findeth the wife findeth a good thing. Marriage with all its troubles and embarrassments is a blessing from the Lord, writes this man of God. It is indeed a blessing from the presence of God. Now, when you see your life partner as God's favor, and that's what God's word says in Proverbs, you know, marriage will not look like hard labor. You know, for some people, you know, it's not hard labor for them. They're about to go to a honeymoon. I'm going to talk about, you know, as the years roll, you know, for some people, marriage becomes hard labor. But when you look at your spouse as God's favor, marriage will not be hard labor. It'll be something which is joyous and enjoyable. And in the same book, the book of Proverbs, in Proverbs chapter 8, verse 35, the Bible says, whoever finds me finds life and obtains a favor from the Lord. And when we read scripture, we need to really pay attention. And that sounded very similar to the verse I just read from Proverbs 18. And this verse in Proverbs 8:35 says, whoever finds me finds life and obtains a favor from the Lord. Now, if you read that chapter, Proverbs 8, that chapter is talking about wisdom. So what God's word is saying is, whoever finds wisdom receives a favor from the Lord. And then we come to the New Testament, and in 1 Corinthians 1:30, Jesus is the wisdom of God. He is wisdom personified. So what is the scripture? Put all the three scriptures, and this is the message. You know, the message is not your wife is your God. No, absolutely not. Okay. But your wife is a gift from God. It's a gift from God. And we need to keep saying hallelujah. And we need to keep thanking God for our life partner. You know, not even in a moment of anger, not even in a moment of frustration, not even when, you know, when the storms are raging around you, should you as a husband, and this is for everybody, should you as a wife say, you know, why did I get married to this person? No, at every second of our life, every nanosecond of our life, every minute of our life, we till our last breath, till death do us part, you know, we keep saying, God, thank you for giving this man. Thank you for giving this woman as my life partner. We keep saying hallelujah for our life partner. So that's the first thing. That's the first thing. And the second thing, the second H from God's word, which I want to remind you of, is the honeymoon. First is the hallelujah. Second is the honeymoon. And the scripture says in Deuteronomy 24 and verse 5, okay, if a man is recently married, he must not be sent to war or have any other duty laid upon him. For 1 year, he is to be free to stay at home and bring happiness to the wife he has married. I wish, you know, some rule makers of Deloitte and Dell and Apollo Health, and these guys are listening to this verse from God's word. It says, a man should be free to stay at home for 1 year, 365 days, to bring happiness to the wife he married. That's God's word. And so newly married men might, you know, get another year extension to stay at home and bring happiness to the wife. The Bible is talking about a 1 year long honeymoon. It's just a symbolic of the lifelong honeymoon a marriage is supposed to symbolize. And Warren Wiersbe, another Bible commentator, a Bible teacher whom I greatly respect, said, God did not want any of the Jewish men to use military duty as an excuse to neglect their families. And what God said to Jewish men, what God said to us in his word, you know, is relevant even today as we get busy with our work, as we do our night shifts and day shifts, and as we have our 8-hour weeks and then 2-hour travel to work up and down. And as we get busy and then we have kids and we have the extended family, very often what goes for a huge 6, okay, is the precious time between the husband and the wife. So as much as I'm glad you both are going to a honeymoon, and I just got the news, and I'm sorry to let the cat out of the bag, you know, they're going to Maldives, and they're going to start the journey very shortly, and that's wonderful. I praise God. But that's just doesn't stop with Maldives. It is actually something which happens every day of your life, every day of a married person's life, a lifelong honeymoon. No matter how busy you are, you know, there should be a time during a day, that 24-hour day, when we switch off our phones, you know, turn off the TV, you know, shut the laptop, and get the laptop from your lap and put your wife on your lap and whisper, warm fuzzies, you know, you are trending in my dreams. You know, say things like that. Okay? I'm sure Japheth has better ideas than these. Okay, you're trending in my dreams, or in the coconut of my heart, you're the water inside. In the coconut of my heart, you're the water inside. You know, you need to actually be, for that love to be fresh and warm and hot. You know, the honeymoon has to happen every day. So harvest first, honeymoon second, and finally, harvesting. Hallelujahs first, honeymoon second, and harvesting thirdly. Okay, the context of the Old Testament verse which I read is that a man was a soldier and his wife was not. Okay, so a man is a soldier, his wife is not a soldier, so he has to stay at home 1 year and bring happiness to his wife. But you know, there's another passage, okay, in the New Testament, in Luke 14:20, where Jesus is actually speaking. He's sharing a story where there's an invitation to a wedding banquet which God will host in the last days. And we are all invited, every person in the human race, no matter what faith, no matter who you are, no matter what your age is, there is a wedding feast organized for us by the creator of this universe, and everyone is invited. So in that story in Luke 14, in the highways and the byways, in fact we have a number of good songs in the church about that parable. You go to the highways and the byways and ask everyone to come in. And there's one man in that story with Jesus narrator who says, I've got married to a wife. He says, that's what the word says in Luke 14:20. I've got married to my wife, so I cannot come. I cannot come to God's wedding banquet. You know what? I want to contrast this Luke 14 passage with what I just read in the Old Testament. See, a woman cannot go and do a battle in that context. But you know what? A woman can come for God's banquet. So what should that man have said? Well, I will bring my wife to the God's banquet. That's what you should have said. He shouldn't have said, I can't come for God's banquet. I can't come for the wedding feast of the Lamb. And that's the phrase that we read in Revelation chapter 19, 7 to 9. The wedding feast of the Lord Jesus Christ. The madman should not have said, I can't come for the wedding feast of the Lord Jesus because I married this woman. Or a woman cannot say, I can't come for the wedding feast of the Lord Jesus because I married this man. You know what? Together as man and wife, you know, you both should join together and go to that banquet and not go alone. You know, bring everybody along the journey. Bring some people from the corporate company that you work for. Bring some neighbors. Bring someone, you know, bring someone you bump into Maldives. You know, everywhere you go, you know, you share the good news of Jesus Christ. Now, every time you talk about Jesus who came and died for us on the cross and rose again on the third day, Jesus who's returning, it's like giving a wedding invitation for that great wedding feast on that final day. And you're going to use your time, your talent, and treasures. And I know Japheth uses his treasures to build God's kingdom. You know, I've been at the other end of his of receiving from his, you know, from his support, his generous hand. And I know Japheth is involved, and I'm sure Preethi is also involved. So not just through your time, to your talents, to your treasures, you're going to build God's kingdom. You're going to invite people to that great wedding feast. Isaiah 5 verse 1, Isaiah talks about God as my beloved. And Isaiah 54, 5, you know, there's a reference where it says, God my husband. You know, no matter we may be male or female, but you know, we have Jesus Christ as our heavenly bridegroom. And at the eschatological end, at that final day, there's going to be a wedding banquet. And we're all invited to be his bride. And we go there. as husband and wife, we go there for that wedding, and we don't go alone. We actually invite people through our exemplary life and through our mouth which shares the gospel. We take people along, and it is my prayer that, you know, Japheth and Preethi would do that throughout their life. We are sitting on a hill, a candle lighted on a lampstand, bringing people to Jesus and inviting people for the great wedding feast of the Lamb. I want to take some time. I want to just close, and I want the congregation, I want Japheth and Preethi, remember these three H's. The first one, hallelujah. Second one, honeymoon. And third one, harvest. So let's ask God to add His blessing to His words. And let's pray. Lord, let's pray for this couple. I'm going to pray right now. And let's pray for each one of us here. No, we may be single, we may be married, we may be old, we may be male, we may be female, we may be young. But, you know, no matter who we are, this message applies to us, because one day, you know, there will be that wedding feast will happen, and we need to be there. We need to take that invitation of the Lord Jesus. You know, every drop that Jesus shed on the cross is an invitation card. His blood says, I love you, I love you, I love you. I died on the cross for you. And going to church Sunday after Sunday is good, but that's not going to actually make us, you know, give us an entry to that wedding feast. But if we can call Jesus my beloved, if we can call Jesus my husband, if that love is there, that deep love, that intimate love is there, then we will be found at that wedding feast. So I'm encouraging everyone here, no matter who you are, you know, I invite you to fall in love with Jesus. Give your life to Jesus. Jesus who demonstrated His love for you on the cross of Calvary. And if you can tell Him, Lord Jesus, I'm sorry for my sins. His blood will cleanse you from every sin. Your sin may be unprintable. You may, even your best friend, you can't confess your sin to that friend. But you come to Jesus and confess it to Jesus. His blood will cleanse you. He will give you a peace which the world cannot give you, which money cannot buy, which the devil cannot take away. That peace will be yours. And you will be on the journey to that eternal, the great wedding feast of the Lamb, of the Lord Jesus Christ. And to Japheth and Preethi, and not just to them, every married couple, do you have that honeymoon going every day? Are you saying hallelujah for your family, for your spouse? That's a question that you should ask yourself. And decide to do that. Don't ever say, oh God, I'm really cursed because I married this woman. No, don't say that. Keep praising God for your spouse, because it's a God-given spouse. If you are married to her, okay, and she's your wife, there is no reason for you to actually think of getting out of that marriage, but you should stay in that marriage and make that marriage work with all your heart and keep praising God for this woman, for this man that God has given in your life. That's the teaching of the Bible. So make a commitment to that end. Shall we pray? Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your word that has come to us. Lord, I commit Japheth and Preethi to Your hands. I pray that You'll bless their married life, O Lord. I pray that they will truly be like a city on a hill, a candle lighted on a lampstand. They will be like Lord, Aquila and Priscilla, building Your kingdom together through a joint effort, through merged Christ reflection. Bless them with every blessing, spiritual and material, financial, or every blessing. Bless them with children, spiritual children, actual children. Bless this wonderful family. Lord, I pray that You'll bless the parents of, Lord, the larger family. I bless Japheth's father, dear Uncle Solomon. Bless Rachel. Lord, bless Preethi's family, mom, brothers, and each one, oh Lord. And I pray that they will be kept in the fort of Your blood. The attack of the enemy will be, Lord, will be far away from them. They will be kept safe in the fort of Your blood, O Master. And we thank You for Your presence, as Japheth testified, throughout every stage, O Lord. Right from the time he first met Preethi, through the engagement and through the wedding, Your presence was there. And I pray that Your presence will be continued to be with them, and not only with them, but the families. And there are people here, Lord, who needs, O Master. And You're a miracle-working God. We have no one to go to but to You, O Lord. And right now, Lord, we come to you and we look to you for a miracle breakthrough, Lord. I pray that you will heal bodies that are sick here. And I pray that you'll provide, Lord, miracles for families that are on the edge and they have no one else to look to, but they look to you, Lord. And Lord Jesus, you are as a miracle worker. You provide a miracle for them according to your will, O Master. Reveal yourself as powerful, and because your word says nothing is impossible for you, O Lord. Wipe every tear, O Lord. Encourage every discouraged heart, O Master. And I pray that there will be new hope that will be born, because your presence is there right now, O Master, in this place, in this home, on this ground, in this congregation. Your presence is there. So, Lord, I pray new hope will be born. And the hope that you give never disappoints. And I pray that you will do a miracle and you will lead this family, O Master. We thank you for this time. And we give you all the glory. We ask all this with thanksgiving in Jesus' matchless name. Amen. God bless.